Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to our worship service here at Kilmarnock United Methodist Church. I am Pastor Penny Corey, and we are truly blessed to have that each of you has chosen to worship with us today. We are a congregation filled with people who love the Lord Jesus Christ and seek to share the gospel message, making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. We give a warm welcome to any visitors. We want to connect with you, so please fill out a visitor card in the pew racks and place it in the offering plate as you leave today. I want to express heartfelt thanks for this congregation's prayers and expressions of love given last week when Bert had his 5-hour heart surgery at VCU. He is here at church this morning, and we want to just say thank you. We want to tell you that the doctors say that they have corrected all three of the places in his heart that needed to be repaired. Praise and glory be to God. I want to remind you that next Monday, February the 14th, is a deadline for our March newsletter. Please have your articles ready for Joanne by that time. Mary Lorenzino is going to come and tell you about an opportunity for our children.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Our children have been having a fun time down in the Sunday school wing this morning, talking about Jesus' love and the different ways that he shares that with us, and we can learn from that. One of the things that the children have made down there are their Valentine mailboxes. I've sent out an email this past week about them, so I just wanted to bring them in and show you an example of what one is. If you have a moment this week and you feel a little special thing tug on your heart to share some of your love with our kiddos, they have their Valentine mailboxes down in the educational wing on the pew out there by the water fountains. If any time this week you would like to slip a little Valentine note in, our children will collect their Valentine mailboxes next Sunday to receive their agape love that the congregation has shared and they've shared amongst themselves. So thank you. We have 15 bags down there. So if you have 15 little Valentines, you can spread them around that way.
Let us stand for our call to worship. Come now into God's presence. We call upon God. Let us lift our voices in song. We praise God. Let us open our hearts to God and listen for God's voice. We sense God's Spirit moving here, now, in this sanctuary. Let us pray. O God, we give you unspeakable, glorious praise. We exalt you, O God Most High. Help us to share in the challenges and the calling of your prophets and disciples to see justice and show compassion. Help us to live and minister to all people, all races, all ages throughout our lives. Help us to be loyal, to act justly, to be obedient disciples, and to walk humbly with our God. Amen. I invite you to turn to hymn 404 as we sing, Every Time I Feel the Spirit.
Thank you.
the time that we bring our thanks, our praise, and our intercessions for others before God's throne of mercy and grace. I'd like to share some prayer concerns with our congregation. Judy Werner went to the ER on Thursday and has been diagnosed with type 2 diabetes and high blood sugar. Several months ago, we began to pray for a 5-year-old, Ava Thomas, with a kind of brain cancer. This week, she checks into the hospital to begin the cycle 2 of her chemo. The family hopes that she can skate through this cycle with the transfusions that she will most definitely need. Please pray for a swift recovery after this treatment and no nasty side effects. Continued prayers for Jim Bennett for complete healing after he received his treatments at Georgetown Hospital. He's feeling tired and having pain. Also pray for the whole family in decisions that they must make in the future. Prayers are welcome for Mary Glasgow. She is still weak from her fall. Prayers continued for Ed and Marlene Gates and their family members. Ed and Marlene have moved in with their daughter, Beth. While the family is working on remodeling the Gates home to accommodate Ed's medical condition. So for prayers in the in-between time that all things will go well. Prayers for Steve Gray. He has been admitted to Norfolk General Heart Hospital, and on Monday they will put a stent in. This is a friend of in Portsmouth. Prayers of sympathy for the family of Virginia Montgomery, a friend of Sonia Headley's. Sonia and Virginia work together in prison ministry. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise be to the Spirit. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Behold, God is our helper. It is the Lord who sustains our lives. In your presence is the fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. O God, establish your kingdom here on earth. Bring your light to shine on Kilmarnock, on our church here at KUMC, and on each one of our lives. Shine, Jesus, shine, that many may receive salvation and forgiveness of their sins. May we be sanctified to grow more and more into the likeness of Jesus every day. Lord, bring your peace and bring an end to all that causes conflict and division in our churches and in our families. Oh God, thank you for being a partner in all of our labors for you, so that all things work together for the good to those who love God and to those who are called according to your design and purpose. Oh Lord, hear our prayers, those spoken and those unspoken. We especially lift up to your throne of grace and mercy those names who we have mentioned today. Thank you for meeting their needs and sustaining them with your presence. We pray for those who need to know for sure that they are saved by your grace. Give hope to the brokenhearted. Give light to those in darkness. We pray for comfort and peace to those who have lost loved ones. O great King of love, let the leaves of the tree of life bring healing to your people. We pray all these prayers through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever, as we pray as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power.
power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
I so much apologize. I had some prayer requests that were given to me earlier in the service. Courtney asked prayers for the family of the Moroccan boy, the 5-year-old Moroccan boy who fell in the well and died. She also asked us to pray for the families of the fallen officers at Bridgewater College. And Judy and Julian Altier asked prayers for Julian's brother, Tom and Shira Altier, and their family, as they mourn the loss of their son, Michael, 40 years old, who died in the night of heart failure on Wednesday. Be with our family as we mourn the loss of Michael. We invite you to stand for affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Singing some spirituals during the month of February, and while my choir is still out, we're trying to get over this bump in COVID. I thought y'all could be the choir this morning. You seem excited. Don't everybody applaud. If you turn to page 722, you don't have to stand up. But I want to sing this spiritual. I want to be ready. Some of you may know it, to walk in Jerusalem just like John. So I'll sing the part that says leader, and you sing the part that says all. And refrain, and this ought to work out just fine. I want to be ready.
I want to be ready. O God, your word is more precious than fine gold and sweeter than purest honey. As we turn to your scripture for today, send your Holy Spirit to infuse your word with truth and grace, so that the good news of your love would shine before our eyes. We pray in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. The reading today is from 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 11, the New American Standard Version. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. For the people of God. Thanks be to God.
The title of our sermon today is, Who You Gonna Call? Let us pray. Oh Lord, show us your light and truth. Manifest your presence among us. Anoint the words of my mouth for the glory of God, so that we will not leave this place the way we came in. We pray in Jesus' holy and mighty name. Amen. This morning, I want to introduce to you someone who was a very unlikely saint. He lived a lifestyle of the rich and the famous. He was born into wealth and privileges. He was a notorious party animal. He lived a life of selfish ease. And much to the dismay of his mother, an upstanding Christian, he hung around with the low life dives of the city. He kept company with the disreputable characters. He had a son by his living girlfriend and made no move to marry her. He was, in short, an embarrassment to his family. One day, this young man had a change of heart. Over the years, he's heard the Christian teachings from his mother, but none of those teachings had stuck. On this particular day, he found himself sitting in the garden in his family estate with a Bible in his hands. He felt troubled by the emptiness of his life. The young man opened the Bible and read these words, "Let us live honorably as in the day, not reveling in drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires." That was Romans 13, verses 13 and 14. Later, that man wrote about how he felt after he had read the scriptures on that day. He said, "Instantly, it was as if a light of peace was poured into my heart, and all the gloom of doubt vanished away. Not long after, this dissolute young man surprised his friends by training for the priesthood. Ultimately, he became not only a priest, but a bishop. It is this very man who is now called a saint in many Christian traditions. His name was Augustine, and he lived in the 4th century. He was an unlikely candidate for sainthood, as you would ever find. Now, let me tell you about the story of an unlikely apostle. God has issued some unlikely calls. For if you scan the pages of the Bible or a book of church history, you'll find all sorts of people who have been touched by God's Spirit, and you'll find those who hear God's calling personally to them, and many respond by saying yes. Such was the person who wrote today's scripture lesson. His name is Paul. Although he wasn't always called by that name, so compelled was his call to discipleship that he dropped his old name of Saul and took on a new name of Paul. No person apart from Jesus Christ himself has shaped the history of Christianity like the Apostle Paul. Even before he was a believer, his actions were significant. His frantic persecution of Christians following Stephen's death got the church started to obeying Christ's final command to take the gospel worldwide. Paul's changed life was evidence that God was using Paul in a special way. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 are the words of Paul, the words he used to describe his changed life, for he said, "For I now hand on to you the good news which you have received, in which you also stand. By this message you are being saved. Now proclaim this message wherever you go." Paul was saying to them, "I personally have proclaimed this message to you, and now I'm asking you to make it your own message, for your belief is the real thing, and you're in this for good." Then Paul goes straight to reviewing the message for them. He tells the credits of his faith, and he tells what he believes. The credits begin with these words, "For I handed on to you what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised again on the 3rd day. Paul goes on to roll the credits, to scroll the names of Peter, and then to the 12 disciples. Then he says, "Christ himself appeared to 500 brothers and sisters, then to James, and then to all of the apostles." It is only after this great roll call of the faithful that Paul dares to list his own name, saying, "Lastly, he appeared to me in one untimely born, to me, a broken wreck of a human being." The Message Bible adds this explanation: "It was fitting that I bring up the rear. I don't deserve to be included in that inner circle, having spent all those doing my best to stamp out God's church right out of existence." For remember that Saul of Tarsus was not just indifferent to Christianity, as was Augustine. Paul adamantly persecuted the church. Saul was a bounty hunter. He rounded up Christians for execution, and it was Saul who held the cloaks of the mobs as they stood to stone Stephen to death. Paul considered himself a huge sinner and a most unlikely candidate for the Lord's work. Yet, who does the Lord choose to deliver his messages? Not the high priest, not the king, but this unlikely sinner named Paul. Paul writes, But by the grace of God, I am what I am. For God's grace has changed me, and I'm not about to let his grace go to waste. Saul was changed by the power of the living Lord, who called out to him on the Damascus road, who plucked him out of his hate-filled life and transported him into the light of the gospel. All of Jesus' disciples were unlikely disciples too. They're all ordinary people like you and me. They're blue-collar workers. None of them had much in the way of education. And by the way, they were not team players. Yet these disciples are the very ones that Jesus invites to join him on a fishing expedition, not fishing for fish, but fishing for the hearts and souls of people. Jesus came into the world like his cousin John, as a witness to testify to the light, John 1 verse 6. And these disciples now would join Jesus in this lifetime mission. So today we might say to God, who are you going to call? Well, God always calls unlikely people to join him. Listen to a few. Abraham is an unlikely recruit. He hears God tell him face to face that his wife will bear a son, and he dares to laugh and disbelieve God. Then there's Moses, who was a murderer. And Rahab. Rahab is another unlikely recruit. She's a temple prostitute. David is a mighty king, but also a mighty sinner. He seduces Bathsheba, then has her husband killed so that he can marry her. And still, David is described in the Bible as a man after God's own heart. Ruth is a widow from a foreign country. She's a worshiper of other gods. But out of love for her mother-in-law, she follows her to Israel, finds a husband, and lo and behold, becomes the ancestor of Jesus. Jeremiah disbelieves, saying, Lord, I cannot speak. I am only a boy. And John the Baptist was a wild man in the wilderness, sometimes given to outbursts of irrational anger. And then there's the tax collector, Matthew, a man so despised that when Jesus decides to visit his home, the people complain that he is around sinners. And Jesus responds, saying, I have not come to call the righteous, but to call sinners. Then there's Peter, who even denied that he had known Jesus. My friends, these are all unlikely disciples, every last one of them. And yet, these are the very ones that God calls. Don't you think God has a sense of humor? In reality, there is only one requirement for being a disciple. And that is the willingness to submit to God's call. You don't have to be smart. You don't have to be strong or healthy. All you need to do is listen when God calls and then get up and do what he tells you to do. I had a dream early this morning. I was walking on a path, and the path led me to a body of water that was very choppy with white caps on the water. In this dream, I looked, and there were people in the water struggling to stay above the white caps. And then suddenly, there appeared a helicopter out of nowhere who came and began to lift the people one by one out of the water, and they were saved. I woke, and I began to wonder why I might have had this dream this morning. And that still, small voice of God came to me saying, there are still many who need to be saved. In 1 Corinthians 15, verses 10 and 11, the Message Bible, Paul says, because God was so gracious and so very generous to me, I am here by the grace of God. It is God who's giving me the work to do, and it is God who will give me the energy to do it. God, who you gonna call? Today in church, or perhaps today listening by live stream, there may be some who still need to be saved. But the scriptures where Paul says some may have believed in vain. So Paul's personal encounter with Jesus changed his life forever, and he was faithful to tell others about Jesus wherever he went. Will you turn yourselves to God this morning? Will you give up your sins, your pride, your complaining spirit, your gossiping, your quarreling, your jealousy? Is there something that God has been asking you to do, but you've said no, not giving in to God's will? Today, will you submit? You may think yourself as an unlikely believer, but don't wait to give your life to God. Don't wait to ask Jesus to save you, for today is the day, for none of us is promised tomorrow. Or for those of us who know we're saved, is there some task that no one else is doing that maybe God is calling you to do? He called me, and he may be calling you today. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 15:11 that our job is to proclaim the good news of salvation so that many will believe. He loves you, and he wants to tell you the truth today. So listen to one of God's love letters, and it's written just for you. My child, you may not know me, but I know everything about you. I know when you sit down and when you rise up. I am familiar with all of your ways. Even the very hairs of your head are numbered, for you were made in my image. In me, you live and move and have your being. For you are my offspring. I knew you before you were ever conceived. I chose you when I planned creation. You were not a mistake, for all your days are written in my book. I determined the exact time of your birth and where you would live. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. I knitted you together in your mother's womb and brought you forth on the day that you were born. It is my desire to lavish love on you, for I am your provider and I meet all of your needs. My plan for your future has always been filled with hope. I rejoice over you with singing. I will never stop you, for you are my treasured possession. If you seek me with all your heart, you will find me, for I am your greatest encourager and comforter. As the shepherd has carried the lamb, so I have carried you close to my heart. I am your father, and I love you, even as I love my own son, Jesus, for in Jesus, my love for you is revealed. Jesus died so that you could be reconciled. His death was the ultimate expression of my love for you. I gave up everything I loved that I might gain your love. If you receive the gift of my son Jesus, you receive me also. And nothing will ever separate you from my love again. I have always been your father, and I will always be your father forever and always. Love, your daddy, the Almighty God. P.S. My question is, will you be my child? I'm waiting for you. God, who are you going to call? Each one of us has a choice. And God is saying to us today, whom shall I send and who will go for us? What will your answer be? Let us pray. Today, Lord, we hear your call. We say, Lord, we believe. We want to follow Jesus. Thank you for loving us. Please come and live in our hearts and give to us your all-sufficient grace like you gave to Augustine and to the Apostle Paul and to each of the early disciples. For by your grace, we have been saved through faith and not of ourselves. Thank you for reaching out to us and calling us who are very unlikely believers to be your witnesses in this world. We pray in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. As we sing this last hymn, hymn number 593, I want you to sing it and I want you to hear God speak to your heart as you respond to him. Let us stand as we sing, Here I Am, Lord. Thank you. We will receive our generous gifts, tithes, and offerings in the plate that are in the back of the church. So now let us sing our doxology. I hope you have felt his presence with us. It is Jesus who invites you to this communion table today. All are welcome to his table of love. If you will turn with me to page 12 and follow in the communion liturgy.
Your mighty acts in Christ Jesus, today we offer ourselves thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us who are gathered here and on these gifts of the bread and the wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in his final victory and we feast at the heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. This is the body of Christ given for you. The blood of Jesus Christ given for the forgiveness of your sins and your salvation. We would ask you to come at the invitation of your ushers this morning. Come down the center aisle, receive the elements. You may are welcome to pause in a moment here at the altar as you receive the elements, and then return on the outside aisles. There are trash cans on either side of the sanctuary. given for you. Take and eat, take and drink. Remember Jesus' love towards you, for you are his precious child. It's the body and blood of Jesus given for you. Take and eat, take and drink. And remember, you are loved. The body and blood of Jesus given for you. Receive from Jesus today.
Now please turn in your bulletins as we pray the prayer after communion. Eternal God, we give you thanks and praise for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. As you leave our service today, please remember to keep safe social distance between you. Please remain in your seats till the ushers ask you to exit the service row by row, starting at the back of our sanctuary. Now please stand for our benediction. My friends, no matter how reluctant we might be to serve, be assured that we do not serve alone. No matter how how dim we feel our light may be, know that we shine brighter because we go forth with the light of Christ. Remember that no matter where we go or what we do so with the certainty that God has called us by name and we are his. Go forth, therefore, in love, grace, and peace of God through Jesus Christ our Lord. We pray in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and the people of God said, Amen.